Twitter uses Scala and they run that Scala code on top of GraalVM. So, you know, they need performance, especially now. And it runs fast, let's just say that. My name is Faraz. I work at DeepSource as a language engineer, and I'm basically the Ruby guy here. So what's the point, right? Like, we are at a Java meetup. Why am I talking about Ruby? So my thinking here is Java is no longer just Java, the language, or just the JVM, right? It's grown a lot bigger than what it started as. It's now, it can run three languages, just JVM itself. So that is Kotlin, Java, Scala. But through GraalVM, it can run around 10 plus languages. So that is like Python, R, JavaScript, even C and C++. So that is amazing. It is like a target in itself, like a compile target. It optimizes heavily on the languages it runs. These optimizations, they end up upstream. Like GraalVM made an optimization in Python, maybe it ended up improving Python. Like in this case, it ended up improving Ruby. So let's see. So what is GraalVM, right? Let's look into it. GraalVM is a Java VM. It was also created by Oracle Labs. It's high performance. It has a low memory footprint, and it runs its own optimizations. So it has like 60 plus academic publications. There's a lot of research going on just to improve performance, memory usage, et cetera. And so it has two things going for it. One is the JVM mode. It will run on top of your hotspot VM. That is your Java VM. But also, it has something called native mode. It will compile your code ahead of time, and then it will compile it down to your native machine code. So you're not running like Java bytecode. You are actually running your CPU instructions. So that is a lot faster to start up. It's a lot, it takes a lot less memory, and it's super performant. And like I mentioned, there's 10 plus languages here. So it does that using something called the Truffle framework. Truffle is basically it provides an AST for your custom language to compile down to, and that AST will then be optimized heavily, and then optimized to have a very fast bytecode, let's say a very fast running of your bytecode. So did I mention 3 billion devices run Java? Okay, so let's see. So you would say, why would we use GraalVM? JVM is already fast enough, right? It's already self-optimizing. But here we have some benchmarks. We can see that across the board, GraalVM code runs either as fast or in some cases a lot faster than your OpenJDK, that's your JDK 11. So it's not just some toy research project. It is being used in production. Famously, Twitter uses Scala and they run that Scala code on top of GraalVM. So you know, they need performance, especially now, and it runs fast. Let's just say that. So Ruby is a nice little language. It's an object oriented language. It has like a clean syntax. If you want to think about Ruby, think it as Python, but more like Bash. So you can create your classes just like you do in Python. you have def keyword for defining your functions. You can inherit from classes, but the thing here is it only has single inheritance. So you can only inherit from one class at a time. So that's why we have this. And it's also very flexible. See, you will see here, I am changing the working of the plus operator itself. So if I change it to return do it yourself. So if you do 1 + 2, it will just print do it yourself. It won't give you like an addition. And I talked about multiple inheritance. So the way we do that in Ruby, we don't do it. We use composition instead. So if you want to, inherit from multiple things, you have something like a module. You can call it like a static class, I believe. If Raghav's here, he'll correct me. But that's how you include something from multiple sources into a single class. So essentially, it works like multiple inheritance, but you won't have like the grandfather problem that you have in Java or somewhere else. So that's a basic gist of Ruby. And Ruby got famous because of Ruby on Rails, the web full stack web framework that powers a lot of your commonly used websites. So famously, GitHub uses Ruby on Rails. They've been on it ever since it wasn't even 1.0. So they've been here for a while. And a lot of companies use Ruby on Rails. You have Twitch, you have Airbnb, Coinbase, SoundCloud, you know, big companies. So it's not some small toy thing. Truffle Ruby. I mentioned the Truffle framework. Truffle Ruby is when you run Ruby on JVM, on GraalVM. So it was started by Chris Seaton in 2013 as his internship project. And recently it gained compatibility with Ruby 3.1. That is the latest version of Ruby as of yet. And it doesn't have a global interpreter log. So in Ruby, if you try to use threads, only one thread can run at a time, but it won't utilize like all your processors. And the benefit of this is if you compile Ruby down to your JVM, your GraalVM, you can also compile it down to your native code. It runs fast. It runs really fast. How fast? Let's just see. On the right, you will see your Truffle Ruby. So that runs on GraalVM. It is almost 6 times faster than Ruby 3.1. Ruby 3.1 is right in the middle. These are all comparisons with Ruby 3.1. So you can see it is wicked fast. That's, I think, the technical term for it. So why would you run Ruby on JVM, right? By the way, did I mention 3 billion devices run Java? So that's why you might need to. So I talked about optimizations, right? GraalVM does a lot of optimizations. So two of the most, I think, impactful optimizations are these ones, like zero overhead metaprogramming. We'll see that why it's important. And there is this recent one called object shapes. Object shapes is also super important. We'll see that in a while. Metaprogramming. So like I mentioned before, metaprogramming in Ruby is just like defining a class. There is no difference in monkey patching a class or defining a class. It just works the same way. Everything works the same way. So just like you saw before, if you do 1 + 2, it will just say, do it yourself, I won't do it. And yeah, so what happens if you do a lot of metaprogramming is that it introduces a lot of overhead. So every time you do 1 + 2, let's say, the VM has to check whether plus was modified. So it goes and checks if it is modified. And so this happens for every function call. So it introduces a lot of overhead. So you can get around that and this is how we end up over here. There was this research project from GraalVM where they essentially managed to get zero overhead metaprogramming. It had a lot of caching that happened because of a lot of caching. And they had, essentially, they were caching the function calls. But the problem with that is on the first function call, it won't be cached. But as you go through your program, if there is a similar function call, it will get cached. And the next time, it is just fast. OK, how fast, right? And so there is this package called psd.rb, which is essentially a piece of code that works like Photoshop. So you can write code, and it does the things that Photoshop does. So they ran this as part of benchmarking this research project. And the speed up that they got was at most like 19 times speed up. So that is not some small speed up. It's like it's what, and even if you see like the lowest, it's at least 10x. So that's a lot of speed up. Okay, another one, another of your optimization is object shapes. Why do we need object shapes? This is why. So in Ruby, there is this thing called instance variable. It's how you store state within an instance of an object. So let's say you created a class called foo. Maybe it has three instance variables, A, B, C. But the thing with instance variables is that in Ruby, by default, anytime you create a class, all its instance variables will get cached the first time. But the problem is the cache key is the class ID. So anytime you inherit from that class, you won't have the cached instance variables. So it doesn't work if you do inheritance. And that's not a good thing in an object-oriented language, right? Because there's a bunch of inheritance happening. If you don't cache the inheritance, then what's the point, right? So that's how they came up with Truffle Ruby actually implements this thing called object shapes. What happens is, think of object shapes as the schema of an object. So let's say in this case, right? This first case. So the foo class only has an instance variable called A. So that is the schema of the foo class right now. If we add an instance variable, let's say B, the schema of the class changes. And similarly, if we add C, the schema changes again. It becomes this thing, foo with A, B, C. And when we inherit this time, the bar class will also inherit the shape of the foo with ABC. So this time we actually have the cached object from foo this time. So we'll have a lot of cache hits. So this thing called upstreamed into C Ruby, that is the main version of Ruby right now. So recently it got merged into C Ruby around like 2 weeks ago. And this made instance variable writes 6 times faster than they were previously. So this is really big speed up, and it's a really big speed up. So yeah, thank you. That was my talk.